Currently, much of decision-making skill development happens through university courses and grassroots informal courses available through mass open course platforms. At universities across the globe, decision-making is taught predominantly in a strictly theoretical manner. Subject courses including decision theory, behavioral decision theory, shared decision-making in healthcare communication, psychology of decision-making, management and economic decisions, and decision support systems in engineering are typically held in psychology, medicine, economics, management, engineering, and applied mathematics departments.
In this course, we'll start by presenting the most important characteristics of decision making, go on to understand what is a walk and why it can be comparable to a decision making process, and then help you build your own exercise with movement.
Despite it being a key skill for life and in many workplaces, the development of embodied decision-making skills for everyday life and work rarely makes an appearance in the curricula of many European universities. While there are plenty of extramural platforms available for interested learners, they may lack the necessary academic rigor and make restrictive assumptions about decision-making. Teaching decision theory requires little outside of the continued development of the rational mind. However, teaching decision-making as a skill seems to require an entire panoply of practical abilities which, although assumed to be known in decision theory, cannot be taught through decision theory. In pursuit of a suitable framework for teaching decision-making skills as opposed to decision-making theory, in this course we will explore the ways in which individuals can be assisted in formulating their own preferences. There is also an ethical aspect to this endeavor, which has to do with the acknowledgement that we are teaching people to be autonomous. Autonomous in defining their preferences, as much as that is possible, with the body of scholarship on the subject available at the moment. It is important to clarify that formulating preferences is different than training one's own preferences in line with certain values or aspects, like making healthy food and lifestyle choices. Formulating preferences is particularly important for those who tend to suffer from indecisiveness, make a choice and then repeatedly change their mind, and frequently experience regret after committing to a certain option. We begin by discussing embodied learning and how it relates to teaching decision-making skills. We will introduce decision-making walk and move on to help you prepare your own course using movement. One of the central concepts in decision theory is that of preference, and the ability to define a preference order between a set of alternatives. This is largely the starting point to any decision-making process. However, field studies have repeatedly shown that individuals' awareness of their own preferences is not always as simple as it might seem, particularly when moving away from trivial choices such as, should I choose a chocolate or a book? Preferences have been shown to violate the fundamental properties of rationality, such as transitivity. If I like A more than B and B more than C, then I like A more than C. Or connectedness, which means I can always compare any two options A and B. These findings have led researchers to construct decision theory models which take into account different premises of rationality than initially considered. in teaching people how to make strictly rational decisions, not what decisions to make, but how to make them, the usual reason brought up for why having a skill like that is essential is that individuals' intuitions are usually terribly wrong. However, there are times when intuition can provide genuine insight, even if other times it does not. Other researchers even consider that intuition can be trained. Therefore, applying a cost-benefit analysis to some types of contexts, such as life, health decisions, for example, and many others, tends to result in severe indecisiveness, because individuals cannot conceive the consequences. At such times, individuals might not be able to conceive whether they care for one option more than the other, and consequently will not be able to define their preference order, a notion that is essential for decision making in a strictly rational sense.
Last but not least, sometimes people want everything, and sometimes they have it. The implication of this is that we don't always have to choose between two options. We sometimes can have both of them.
For decision making, we need to understand that we do not act only from our mind, nor do we only act from our bodies. The concept of body is regarded as an ensemble of subconscious processes and the materialization of these processes. The concept of mind, on the other hand, is regarded as an ensemble of conscious processes. The interaction between the conscious and the subconscious processes appears within certain contexts and leads to certain behaviors, body-wise, and attitudes, mind-wise. A combination of conscious decisions and unconscious choices determine how we behave and what attitudes we hold. Conscious and subconscious acts are neither positive nor negative, but they each serve a purpose. Sometimes people make conscious choices which come against their conscious decisions. Other times they don't make any conscious decisions in contexts when they would like to, and all these come against their own goals. When many people act in ways that are not consciously driven, societies even may suffer. For these reasons, it is important to understand that in decision making, we ought not to use only the mind, and not only the body, not only the conscious decision making, nor only the subconscious choices. Instead, we need to adapt them to the appropriate context. When it comes to teaching decision-making skills, we are teaching people how they should make decisions in a variety of settings. Therefore, decision theory alone, which is based on mental processes mostly, is not sufficient. Moreover, the very processes which lay at the origin of decision theory are based on the notion of preference formation. And in preference formation, the mind and the body, the conscious and the unconscious, come together and need to collaborate effectively if one desires to achieve an autonomous decision. Autonomy is a value, and this makes it just as valid to not value autonomy in decision making as it is to value it. Still, at the basis of our society, autonomy is declaratively a treasured value, although sometimes it isn't much in our behavior. In other words, we say we want something we don't always do. This course is here to seed the basis for aligning what we say we want and what we do. Drawing on the latest developments in cognitive theory and embodied learning, we propose two educational strategies for teaching one of the basic decision-making abilities involved in preference formation and goal setting.